Frans Kempen has been a friend with the Blockchain Alliance for a long time. And Frank is really special because he's of course he's a salesman, he's a consultant, he's doing a wonderful thing in all kinds of in business, but he also is a moderator at the Bitcoin Wednesday. And Bitcoin Wednesday is where the nerds really come together, and they talk about the latest crypto blockchain. And he's able, as somebody who comes from the enterprise consulting, to talk to these people. And even they asked him to be the moderator, and he also moderated tech session. And he's got an extremely interesting case, which is very close to my heart, because I mean I'm into blockchain, but I'm also into electric driving. And what do we need for electric driving? Batteries. And what do we need for batteries still?
Cobalt.
We need cobalt. And where do we get all that? We get that on the most nicest places in the world. And he's basically busy organizing that. So give him a big hand, special guy.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Vincent, for the kind words. And indeed, I see some familiar faces. Some faces also were here last year when we were here on stage presenting the car transportation platform of Koopman. And now John will be here on stage as well later today to present his European venture. So he's now CEO of a European car transportation consortium. So he's working with his competitors, his former competitors, forming this European consortium, providing services on a European scale towards car manufacturers and end consumers. So you see, you can start small and grow big, forming a consortium. And indeed, this is basically my talk. My talk is about the batteries. Small battery for a car, but the electric cars these days have huge batteries, right? And we discussed it already. In batteries, cobalt is as a mineral. Cobalt is mined in Congo for 60% of the cases, and the cobalt is mined often also using child labor. So my talk is about a very practical domain. It's about technology, basically. I'm running a project to do a cobalt provenance project. So to prove where the cobalt source is from and to extinguish, let's say, the cobalt we are on our platform to certify that it's child labor free. Let's see. So this is the three topics, right? So what is the business problem we're going to solve? How do the delivery roadmap looks like? That's the majority of my presentation. It will be very practical. The team who is working, what are we doing, how are we coding, etc. And then, yeah, you have to do this why question. I mean, what do you feel in a why question? So, well, why are lessons learned always lost, right? So I will have one slide with lessons learned. So the problem is that indeed the cobalt is mainly sourced from Congo. Amnesty International has a big report 2 years ago in saying, well, this is what we die for. A lot of OEMs, car manufacturers, are there mentioned as supporting child labor in Congo. But child labor is only used with ASMs. You see on the bottom, only 20% of the cobalt is mined by ASMs. ASMs is artisanal, small-scale mining operations. These are basically mama and papa, small companies, and there's no human right respect on those companies. The majority of the cobalt is sourced in Congo by large-scale mining companies. And this is the clients we are working with at the moment and our focus on of our use case. So this cobalt goes to battery manufacturers. In an average Tesla, there's 10 kilograms of cobalt. So looking at the demand peak in the next 10, 20 years on the cars, electric, on the batteries, there's a huge spike increase on cobalt. And when you buy an electric car, you are environmental conscious, right? You want to have a clean car without carbon footprint, etc. But you also care about human rights. So this topic about human rights, avoiding child labor, is really key on this domain as well, to avoid, let's say, to have a battery in your car which is ethically sourced. This Global Battery Alliance, which is a global alliance with many participants from battery manufacturers to mining companies to car manufacturers, etc., and also auditors, is a part of a project in the World Economic Forum. They started a few years ago. It's a big topic there, and they're proposing guidelines and templates for auditing. So how does the supply chain look like in Congo? So there's the cobalt will be mined, it will be transported to harbors. their ports and customs. Then they will be shipped to mainly China, where the smelters, refineries, and battery manufacturers are situated. And then after the battery is produced, it will be distributed to the car manufacturers, basically, in Europe, US, or China, or Korea. So it's quite a long supply chain. So the EV cars have a long supply chain, and you would want to have visibility on the source, right? So you have a car, and then you need to track and trace back to the origin where it's from. Now, this cobalt is mined in bags. So it comes out of the mine, it will be put in bags, the bag gets a seal with a unique ID code, and then the bag is put in lots. A lot is a collection of, let's say, 20, 30 bags. That will be put on the truck, and then it goes off. What's the problem is often not only that the mining operation on the ASMs is not human rights friendly, but also that when you have clean cobalt, so to say, during transportation, the bag is opened, clean cobalt is taken out, bad cobalt is taken, put in, and sold at the same price. So you have also fraud during the entire process. And not only this aspect, also the aspect of documentation, certification. You have a lot of cross-border transportation, you have shipping, you have customs. So the same problems you have with trade lanes, let's say having a container shipped from China to Rotterdam takes huge cost. So the cost of non-transportation for container shipping is almost as much as the transportation cost. Also in this case, there are a lot of costs involved, and you can decrease those costs by using a transparent system of sharing information. So a lot of elements in this case come together when sourcing, when tracking and tracing the cobalt. So what we are trying to do is the provenance, building a cobalt provenance platform. So proving where the cobalt comes from. And it's not only cobalt, but of course in a battery goes more minerals like nickel and zinc. But cobalt is the first mineral. So after that, we are going to chase the other minerals as well in working with global mining companies. So how does the delivery roadmap look like? What is our team doing, basically? So roll up your sleeves and get some coding done. As a roadmap, first you define a vision with the client, right? What is it he tries to achieve? Then you have a design thinking workshop, having lots of use cases, etc. But then define the use case, which is very simple, very clean, very small scale, and start coding and selecting on that use case. And this use case in this case is, let's say, the cobalt tracking from the mine operation to the refiner in China. Not more than that. That's the first phase. Then we do solution design. Let's say, okay, what are we going to build? What is the architecture behind it? And then we're going to develop code. And the blue circles are the phases we are in at the moment. So develop code in agile sprints, set up the cloud infrastructure, and build a consortium, a business consortium model. Like Jürgen just mentioned, we just started this project on consortium build. We are already working for half a year on the technology side, but during the technology side, our mining clients have come together, and now we're discussing, let's say, forming a kind of consortium. You should do this always in parallel, right? Because the consortium output has impact on your technology roadmap as well. Then we have these MVP, which we're working on at the moment, then a trial, going into production, and run and maintain. That's basically the outline of the project. So what is the delivery team? We are working Agile Scrum in our teams always. And what I like on this team is two elements. One is the majority of this team have worked already on WeTrade. And we also know WeTrade from last year's conference, right? Where we built a trade finance environment for 15 banks in Europe. So half this team worked on WeTrade, so they have the scars of the battle. They made the mistakes, and they're doing a great job at the moment on our platform. The other element I like is that this team is really focused into one location. We spread in Groningen and Amsterdam, and doing an agile sprint methodology together with your client, you need to be very closely aligned together within your team and within the client. So two main elements, right? Design is key. Development and architecture. Those are the big components which are really key in delivering and developing your platform. On the client side, it's basically also educating your client how Agile Scrum development methodology works. Most clients are used to waterfall or whatever other methods, but let's say Agile Scrum is, I mean, you cannot define the output in advance. So if the client asks you, okay, what is the deliverable after 1 year? I cannot tell. They need to trust us that we have a good team of developers and we can do whatever they want. So it's a road, a winding road, so to say. So together with the client, you see, okay, what are the requirements and how does it fit the roadmap which you're going to achieve in the future? So the product owner on the client side is really important for our Scrum Master. And forgive me, I will mention some details in this project. I know the Scrum Master is in this audience, also one of the developers in this audience. So Monday in the stand-up calls, I get beaten probably because I told something which is not correct. So I will prepare for that for the next two days. But I'm really happy that let's say, we have a good team and a good Scrum Master who's really interfacing intensely with the client, have day-to-day calls, stand-up calls with our client organization. Busy slide, but this is basically the technology behind it. So the green in the middle, that's basically the essence of the blockchain platform. That's Hyperledger Fabric, where each client has his own node. This is a picture of three companies with IBM, having its own node on the platform. It can be extended, of course, going along the way and evolving more participant companies in this platform. So on the outside, you have this application layer and then the user interface. There's a whole data and slides set behind it. I will not go in detail, but this is basically on IBM Cloud, we run the IBM blockchain platform, which is a preset configured set of nodes which is already set up for a blockchain environment, which you can add a service on top of. As a flavor, as a view, how this looks like. So we are now 6 months working already and going for another 6 months until the end of the MVP. This is what we have built at the moment. So mining companies and traders and other participants can log into the system. Then they can see the bags of cobalt, which is identified, has an ID, have a seal ID, and are collected on the mine site there. So you have unassigned bags, you have ready for transport, and you have lots in transit. So this is a process flow which you build into your user interface. So the drill down of each bag of cobalt. So you drill down, you say, well, this is a bag of cobalt, and there's some information about it. For instance, you will see here the assay ID. What is an assay? Assay is basically a test what the quality of the cobalt is. So during transportation, there's an audit what the quality is of the cobalt if it's not been tampered with. So the seal is opened, there's a test out of, and there's a document produced what the quality is, what the grade is basically. Then the seal is closed again and it will move on. So you can track and trace the quality of the cobalt in the entire supply chain. You have a question, Vincent?
No, you have 0 minutes.
0 minutes? I've some interesting talks here to go. So let me do three more slides.
Okay.
So this is the cobalt grade, right? The test. This is the assay report. It's a document stored on the blockchain, and this is seal ID. So you get a lot of more information on this drill down menu. I will go on. So we are here now in this MVP phase, minimal viable product. We are 8 sprints ahead. Each sprint is 3 weeks. We have a few sprints to go until the end of this year. Then we go into a production pilot, which is a number of sprints. We cannot tell exactly, but you need to do the integration with your legacy systems. You need to build the non-functional requirements. You need to do the security. You need to prepare for production for real life data. Then you go into production, you go into the DevOps phase. We are planning now end of next year, maybe early after, to go into production with a few mining companies. In parallel to that, as I mentioned, we're going into the consortium build track, where there's a huge lot of information behind it, right? But let's do a wrap-up of this. So you start with the network intent. So what kind of consortium would you like to be? Will you be a founder-led consortium? Or will you be a consortium of competitors? So you have an industry consortium. So all your competitors are on the same platform. So all the cobalt in the world is on this platform, all the data. And on top of that data, you can provide all kinds of services. Or you have, a cross-industry model. Then you have the governance model. Decide how you govern your consortium, basically. We have formed 11 questions, but there are many more behind it. And of course, you have the business value design, about what is the business case, who is going to pay, who is going to earn money, what's the incentive model for each of the consortium partners. So, my last slide, Vincent. What are the lessons learned on a high level? Of course, the basic question, distributed database or blockchain, right? The essence of the answer is trust. Permission platform or open platform, permissionless. Strong management by I cannot enforce because you will have disappointments during your entire journey. And if you have disappointments, things are not going well, you need support of your management to continue working. Select extremely simple, minimal viable product because it's difficult enough, this stuff. And clients need to learn about development methodology. You need to have a hand-in-glove situation with your client. Otherwise, you will not succeed. And agree both the functional and non-functional early. And the last one is the most important one, is the consortium build. The technology is not a problem. Of course, there are challenges in technology, right? But we know this stuff. It's about the consortium build, which is totally new domain in the entire world that competitors are working together on a joint platform. So what about antitrust? We have huge antitrust discussions, right? So if all the data of the cobalt and the price is on the platform, you can selectively tweak demand and supply on this platform, right? On the data. And then you can influence the price, the market price. So antitrust is a big issue in our model, but also the governance around it. So enemies who are beating themselves, each other, already for tens of years, and now sitting in the same room working on joint cooperation. That's a really big challenge, and Jon Kuiper with Venturas has the same challenge he will talk about. So I see Vincent nearing my, so I need to finish, right? So this was my talk, yeah. And indeed, think big, start small, and fail fast. That's the essence of this world. Thank you very much.
Okay, now this is interesting. Your colleague said, first do the consortium, then build the technology. And here somebody goes, oh, we're going to do this and that and that and that. Oh, and then by the way, we're also building in parallel, yep, the consortia. So you basically two are completely,
yep,
within a company. That's possible.
Well, it's also possible that not every client is the same. Mm-hmm. So you will discuss with client in advance, well, you need to start building a consortium and then you build the technology. But some clients, well, I don't buy the consortium. I'm just going to start.
You had one client, he said he wanted to do it, and then said, okay,
exactly.
Good.
So during the roadmap of starting building this platform, we discussed with them even further, mm-hmm, and then they saw, well, it's good to build a consortium. Yeah. That's why we started halfway.
Yeah, and you didn't do that mask mistake. You know, it's not being totally dominated by...
No, okay, good. No, exactly. We learned from every mistake we made, right?
This is an interesting question. I think you will like this question. It's like a shared cow, which is milked by all but fed by a few. What's the business model? That's a great... Kuhn? Who's Kuhn? Who's Kuhn? Great question, yeah.
Well, the business model is that the end customers of electric cars...
Yeah, would Volkswagen, like, $50 billion in batteries,
exactly,
which they cannot buy anywhere, yeah.
So as a consumer, you want to have an ethically sourced car, also ethically sourced battery, mm-hmm, and you want to pay for this, right? There's a premium on this. So this premium will be sourced back upstream to the miner, basically. Mm. So you have a premium if you sell, let's say, solid human rights respective goods.
Okay, is it then 1% premium in cost of this to have this trust-taking trace, or is it 0.1%? How much does it cost to set up something like this?
To build this?
Yeah.
That's too early.
In the end, I mean, you buy a ton of cobalt. How much is a ton of cobalt?
A ton of cobalt is 50,000 euros.
So, I mean, you can track and trace a ton of cobalt for, you know, like 50 euros or 100 euros. So it really doesn't matter anything about the amount of money, doesn't really matter.
Well, you never say that doesn't matter, right?
But the tracking and tracing doesn't cost a lot, right? In terms of the 50,000 for...
Exactly. Well, the value of cobalt is really high.
Okay.
And the demand is spiking, so the value will increase. Let's say the value of the platform is about the use of the platform, right?
Yeah. Yeah, and it's a good way to get premium money. Okay, Frans, good luck. We'll see you next year when
you
have it in production.
Yeah. Thank you very much.